On behalf of the School of Research, Dean Dr. Jayanti, heads, deans of all schools, and members of staff of all departments, I request our respected principal, Dr. M.G. Raghunathan, to kindly deliver the welcome address. Sir, please.
Most respected General Secretary and correspondent in absentia, Sardar Manjit Singh Nayyar, convener of this program, Dr. J. Jayanti, Dean Research, Guru Nanak Center for Research, resource person of the day, most beloved, our friend, Dr. A.R.T. Arasu, former head, Fish Culture Division. Madam, while you are introducing him, you said that he is called as A.R. Thirunav Karasu, but he has got one more name called as Seabass, father of Seabass. If I am correct, because he is the one authority of in India, and he is authority Seabass in this program. And for your information, he is our colleague, Dr. Venu's guide. And so he is an amazing person today. He is being with us and resource person of the day. And our beloved Vice Principal, Dr. L.R.S. Kalani, Dean Sciences, Dr. Noor Jahan, Dr. Mahendra Kumar, Dr. Sivakumar, Dr. S.S. Jairaj, Dr. Devakumar, our alumni is also present here in this group, Dr. Bhuneshwari, my dear Dr. Bharati Ravikrishnan, Dr. Elarisi, and Dr. E. Gayatri from the department, a galaxy of people like even Dr. Gopi, HOD, Dr. Srimadhi, Dean, Admin Sciences, and my dear friend, Dr. Venu, and all my colleagues and my dear students. Today, this is a wonderful day. Why I am saying is that the NAC or the NIRF, whatever it is, they are asking for what is the industry, academia, and the relationship between any of the academic institutions. And this is a wonderful event arranged in research that is a conclave, and I could see there is a galaxy of eminent personalities present in this for these 5 days that has been arranged. One, my humble request is that, sir, Dr. Arasu, sir, I again and again request you. Last meeting also, I saw you in Tyagaraya College. My request is, sir, those students who study zoology, there should be some relationship between the industry and our institution so that people, our students, can get some employment opportunities. Or else they can take on their own some entrepreneurship in the aquaculture areas. And today I hope your lecture will be of more of coastal aquaculture perspectives, and students will be very much benefited. And in that way, this today's program is a very memorable program of all these programs held during this coastal, during this lockdown period. And with these few words, I once again a hearty welcome, I extend my hearty welcome to our resource person. And all my colleagues. Thank you. Thanks for that. Thank you. I once again welcome.
Thank you, sir, for your energizing words of welcome and for being a constant motivator in all our endeavors. Every word of yours is motivational, inspiring, and informative. Thank you for giving us more information about our resource person of the day. Really, I'm very glad, and I salute our resource person, the father of Seabass. Thank you, sir. Next.
Seabass.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, next I invite the Dean Research, Dr. Jayanti, who is the brain behind this initiative, to kindly give the introductory remarks about this 5-day Industry Academia Conclave 2020 and to kindly introduce our chief guest. Over to Dr. Jayanti.
Very good afternoon to all the participants who have joined all over the country to attend this Industry Academia Conclave on Aquaculture. I can see there has been an overwhelming response to understand the relationship between the industry and the academic institution, and to understand the lacuna that exists between the two to create more employability for the students. Am I audible, sir? I'm not very sure.
Yes, ma'am. Audible, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir. Before I begin to introduce the resource person of today, Dr. A.R.T. Arasu, I would say that if I am completing the entire biodata of Dr. Arasu, I need this entire conclave to do so, because his entire biodata spans for pages and pages together, and it just to concise and bring it to a certain brief level itself is a very big task for anyone. So I think I will not be doing justice, but still I'll try my level to maintain it very briefly. Let me introduce the speaker of today. you need to give me some time. Yeah. Dr. A.R. Tirunavukarasu is a former principal scientist and head of division fish culture, Central Institute of Brackish Water Aquaculture and Indian Council of Agricultural Research, Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India. He has done his PhD and MSc in marine biology. He has 39 years of research experience in marine fisheries management, inland fisheries development and brackish water aquaculture. To state his employment record, he started out as a research assistant in the Department of Fisheries. Then he became a scientist S1 in SIBA ICAR, and then he became scientist S2. And he moved on to senior scientist cadre, then the principal scientist, and finally the head of the division of fish culture in SIBA. He has made significant contribution related to the field of his specialization. To name a few, the technology for the year around breeding and seed production of Asian sea bass, the technology for the controlled breeding and seed production and domestication of Asian sea bass, the technology for nursery rearing of Asian sea bass, and protocols for the maintenance of captive broodstock milkfish and techniques for the assessment of maturation of milkfish. I can keep talking on the only contributions, but I'm going to make it very brief. So he's also done about polyculture of fin fishes and other fishes. Regarding his awards and recognition, he has a gold medal award and citation for the excellent contribution in sea bass breeding for the first time in India. He is also the recipient of the Hira Lal Chowdhury Award for the best fish farmer, the Sagar Ratna Award 2019 by Uttara Karnataka District Fish Farmers Association, Utkal Maha Gaurav Award by the Sahada Fish Farmers Odisha. He has also been felicitated by Madanganj Matsya Samiti Bengal. He has also received appreciation from ICAR for the year-round breeding and seed production for Asian sea bass under controlled condition. He has also received appreciation from Dr. R.S. Paroda, the then Director General of ICAR, New Delhi, for the breakthrough in sea bass breeding for the first time in India. He has also received appreciation from the industry, that is Pancham Aqua, for the excellent training on sea bass breeding and larval rearing. He has also taken up some special assignments, like being the chairman of the Fisheries Technocrats Forum, Chennai. He is also the chairman for the, he has also been the chairman for the steering committee for evaluating the status of inland fish seed production and advise future strategies for improvement in Tamil Nadu. He's also been the member of the planning board of the Tamil Nadu Veterinary and Animal Sciences University, the member for the project evaluation of Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, the member of the Task Force for Fisheries Development in Tamil Nadu, and member of Fisheries Research Council, member of the board of director for the Center of Aquaculture. I can keep telling. He's been on the panel member for the discussion on tsunami effects on fisheries aquaculture MPEDA, and he's also been with the member in the Institute Biosafety Committee, and he's also been a member of the 11th Plan Policy Drafting Committee. And I can just keep going. He's also been board members for many of the institutions like Anna University, University of Madras, and other things. And some of the important research projects that he has handled is the developmental technology for quality seed production, and he has also handled refinement of fish culture, culture of brackish water fin fishes, ecophysiology of pinnate mono pinnate prawns, sea ranching of marine prawns and mass production of pinnate prawn seed, and culture of marine prawns. Some of the projects that he has handled is Indo-French collaborative project and National Fisheries Development Project, and he has had a NIAP project on export-oriented marine value chain, DBT-sponsored project, an NATP project, mega seed project of Asian sea bass to a tune of 68 lakhs, and he has also done a project on evaluation of the nutritive value of different strains of rotifers. Apart from this, he has also offered consultancy on the transfer technology for Asian sea bass and seed production, consultancy for milkfish breeding, consultancy for establishment of sea bass hatchery, and consultancy for Simsul FAO for Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry. He has done different programs, and the main programs I would like to say is the Kisan Melas that he has organized. That is, he's organized Kisan Melas in 2009 at Nellore on the farmer interaction meet on Asian sea bass. He has conducted interaction meet on Asian sea bass at 2010 in Tirgali, and the farmer interaction meet on Asian sea bass in Karakal, and the exhibition on the farmer meet he has arranged in the annually. So you have he has done different publications in national and international journals. The number of papers is 56, and I think this is the maximum I can really brief his data. Thank you so much, Arasita, for being here, for having accepted our invitation.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Jayanti, for your meticulous compilation and neat presentation about the objectives of this 5-day program and about a resource person whose profile is amazing and inspiring. I am reminded of the Kural. Thondril Puhalur Thondrugar. Sir deserves that appreciation. Sir, you are a rare gem of a person with these many credits to your passion and heart. Yes, friends, now we have come to the most awaited moment. On all your behalf, may I now invite our most respected resource person, Dr. A. R. T. Arasu, to kindly take over the proceeding.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It's really a great engagements given to me. I am not sure that whatever told is correct or not. We have done what is possible with when to during my career. I am very happy to be associated with your program. First of all, and outset, I should congratulate and compliment the organizers having selected this wonderful topic. Aquaculture perspective under the umbrella of the industry, academia, and conclave. See, I know about the Guru Nanak College some 30-35 years back. In 1970s, I used to come that side when some of my friends were there. Later, some of the time, I used to visit, but of late, I understand that the institution has grown up enormously. Thanks to the, now you are equipped, especially the Department of Zoology, has got an excellent, illustrious, wonderful personality, a motivating gentleman as a principal. Your principal is known. He is one amongst the best academicians in India. He is associated with the Indian Science Congress. I especially thank for him. I also met other faculty members. That the Jayanti is there. He was a great biotechnologist, a zoologist. He is doing a wonderful job. Some of my colleagues and friends are there working. When Venu asked me, why don't you also join for this webinar thing? I was a little reluctant because as a retired person, what I am going to contribute. But nevertheless, old is always gold. Sharing experience will always enlighten the youngsters to a greater extent. This is what we can do at the moment. We have done whatever possible over the years. As far as I am concerned, I have been associated with the coastal aquaculture since my career, except that a couple of years I was with the Tamil Nadu State Fisheries Department, where I was associated with the reservoir fisheries, a magnificent reservoir, Manisagar, 1970s, 75, 76, 77. I used to see wonderful katla, mirgal, rogu from the reservoirs. That was my starting career. Afterwards, I joined with the Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute. I was posted at a very remote area, but now it is a part of the metropolitan city Ernakulam, where Nyarakkal, many of the aquaculturists might be knowing, heard about it. It's one of the cradle of the coastal aquaculture in India. Today, most of the aquaculture is managed by the students, by the academics who have started, come and seen and gone, attained by that center. In that way, later, a lot of developments, the aquaculture per se is a wonderful industry as of today. In that context, why do we need aquaculture? Is, you know, fisheries is a very important product. Which supports to the about the animal protein, and the cheapest animal protein is, and even today, you can get a variety of taste, flavor, texture, starting from all economic criterial people from different strata of the society. This is one of the products which will cater from 5 rupees a kilo to 5,000 rupees a kilo. Diversity, the best of the fish product. It meets the requirement of the population. It is the per capita consumption per se in the world is around 20 kg. Some of the countries far exceeds, like Japan, Thailand, many of the Southeast Asian countries. But as far as India is concerned, we are very low profile. It is around 6.5 kilos per hectare per annum, because India is considered as one of the vegetarian countries in the real sense. The global fish production is in the order of around 172 million tons, of which mainly the capture contributes around 52%. The rest is contributed by the culture process. Fishery is not only as a food, it is a process of employment. It supports an employment of more than 60 million people over the world. In India too, is a substantially more than 4 million people are engaged in the fishery sector directly. Indirectly, it goes without saying, because it's one sector where it caters the need of employment from starting from harvesting to the end of the cooking. A plethora of a galaxy of the entrepreneurs, women environment, all of you might be so knowing that how the fishes are being handled. Mainly the catch is by the fishermen, directly marketing is by the fishermen, cutting is by the men, and the cooking is by the women. So this is one sector which provides direct gender equity as far as the employment is concerned. And we would like more and more people to get involved in that. It is identified as one of the growth sectors. That's the reason why our government also has recently come out with a blue economy, because now then we have to look for the water for many of our developments. One is the fish, because 72% of the global is with the sea, and the sea provides all the materials apart from this fish. So we are now looking at the sea as a livelihood option, as a food producing sector, as an employment sector, as a what not else in the world. Whether it is tourism, whether it is urbanization, whether it is any activity concerned with the anthropogenic activities, the sea and the water frontier is civilization also start from there. And that's why the aqua is considered as a thing. Aquatic animals are still more important, because you all know that this has got the three-dimensional. One is this surface, another is the column and the bottom, which none of the animals except this type of aquatic animals can put in use. That's why we always look for the higher, the smaller the area, higher the production from this fauna and flora. That's why the this fisheries is considered very important. It's estimated around 59 million is engaged in the aquaculture. In total, about 20.5 million people are employed in aquaculture. 39 million people are increasing day. It is slowly increasing day by day. Women in fisheries account just about 14% of the population workforce only. With all said and done, the fisheries, for example, I told this around 152 million equally supported more or less by capture and culture. The capture fisheries that as of today is in most of the cases is stagnating or declining. It goes without saying. Whatever the developments have taken place to catch the whatever the aquatic environment, is as of today, we have to make some compromise, because in many cases, it has exceeded the maximum sustainable yield. And it's afraid that more than 70% of the stocks are overexploited in the sea and in the aquatic system. So how we are going to increase our production for meeting the requirements of the growing millions? Even for example, India, to take it, we will be surprised. For our capture fisheries in the sea, we can sustain only about around 4 million tons only. Roughly now the recent estimation has slightly increased. But already we are catching around 3.9 million tons of fish. How we are going to improve for the growing population? With all the things, we have put to increase our catch effort, our population is increasing, our catching efficiency is increasing. Now then you would have heard about the Persian fisheries. Lot of conflicting things are going on. One man wants to catch more and somebody wants to catch less. So they are fighting that you should not do that. Many options are put forth that to reduce the catch effort, reduce the catching efficiency, and try to go for the catching quota. All these are tried, which involves a lot of socio-economic things. So to increase, to sustain the increasing demand, we have to go for the aquaculture. It is the only option to put forth. It is not only for this, it will give us the quality of the fish, because when we talk about aquaculture, we will be going only for the best qualities, which can be put in the more use. For example, 30% of the fish is being wasted. It's not going to the plates of the people. So we will be going for product which will cater the need, better fish, better meat, so that the production can be saved. And then we can recycle the resources, reduce the pressure on wild stock to a greater extent. And it will also support the sea ranching. That is one thing which we are thinking of, stock enhancement in the aquatic system. Now then we say that this, we are reaching the maximum sustainable sea yield and maximum effort is put in, and then the stock is getting depleted. We advocate in many other ways to sustain the yield. One such a thing is you go for the better, give them a chance to thrive, save the breeders, save the adults, don't catch the juveniles. These are all some of the slogans we put forth to the fisheries and fishers. But nevertheless, we also try to support, if once the aquaculture is significantly effort is put in, lot of seeds, lot of feed can be produced, which will can be supplemented into the ecosystem, which will have that things. And then we can integrate the different aquaculture system. There is a herbivore, there is a carnivore, there's a primary carnivore, there's a secondary and tertiary, which will get at this. For example, if the aquaculture system, if I got the bottom feeder, a filter feeder like the mussels and bivalves, which will take about the minimum of the filter feeders, that will cater the need of the, then that will go as a feed for the poorest of the poor or the protein rich. Then from there, that will be a produced feed will go to the primary consumers like the herbivorous species. Then it will be going to the secondary consumers and tertiary consumers, high valued predatory fishes. It's what multi-trophic aquaculture systems now we are trying to efficiently put in our system. So it will be creating a lot of ecosystem balancing will come, though there is a conflict now at the moment. Rational utilization of the aquatic system for the aquaculture, properly taking the inlet water, treating them and leaving the quality water in the system, will make that great effort to see that the ecosystem is restored. A typical example is if you rather take the water, you'll be cautious. So it is becoming a moral bound duty for the aquaculturist or the per se, to see that the nearby ecosystem is saved, otherwise his own crop is will be spoiled. This we have got a typical example somewhere. You heard about a nearby Nellore district, we have got the Gandaleri Creek, where from we also get the Krishna water, which is highly eutrophic conditions have taken now a lot of evolvements. So aquaculturists themselves feel that the aquatic system has to be saved carefully. That's where the aquaculture will help us. So the global aquaculture is somewhere around 47% of the total production is supplemented or produced by the aquaculture. The major producers are the Asian countries. About 90% of the aquaculture produce is from the Asian countries, mainly from the Japan, which supports around 60% of the, China, which supports more than 60% of the aquaculture production globally. And we, the India, is second, but it's the last second, as if somebody has done with a speed about 10 seconds, a man running with the 2 seconds, he will sell the second. That is the case as far as India is concerned. We are far behind. Our contribution is not more than around 7% of the global aquaculture production. So we would like to put forth our efforts, but we feel that our resources are better, and then if it is judiciously and properly being used. Indian aquaculture is a traditional activity. It's not a new as far as India is concerned, especially the coastal aquaculture. Aquaculture is one of the propositions which started civilization, the man's civilization. When it started, it would have begun thousands of years back. That's why there is the Chinese proverb, give a man, teach a man how to grow a fish rather than ask teaching a man how to harvest. That is the proverb, because he knows. And we also have got the things the Egyptians have done, Indian aquaculture has got a tradition. And aquaculture is nothing but just analogous to the agriculture, where you make some embodiments, put in your animals or plants, and then grow them with the little care, take it out, the best of it. That is where the aquaculture is not a big thing. And we the Indians, are also doing aquaculture, especially the coastal aquaculture as a traditional practice in the low-lying areas of the brackish water areas, like which is in Kerala, the Pagali fields, some of you might have heard about. And the because we have got excellent resources of the very large reservoir rivers, which confluence the sea, forms the estuaries. And when the high tide or the tidal influences comes, the water inundates the low-lying fields in the case of Kerala, West Bengal, some parts of Karnataka, Goa, and all these places, which is known as Pakali fields, Kar fields, and berries and gherries of West Bengal. There, people used to trap whatever the seed that comes in, allow them to grow for a particular time, goes on. This is what we have been doing as a traditionally. And India contributes, our total production is mainly by the aquaculture, is by the Indian inland aquaculture by the Indian major crops, and then mariculture is another potential source yet to be developed. I'll go back. The freshwater aquaculture is mainly dominated by the Indian major crops, Katla, Rogu, Mirgal. Of course, they have brought in the new exotic species like the common carp, and then the grass carp, silver carp, brigade, and all. And then small fishes like catfishes, magur, this type of fishes are also being good. We also brought the very important fish up today is the catfish, the Mekong catfish, that is the Pangasius, which is making a big inroad in some of your aquaculture system. Though not it is desirable, but as a production point of view, people resort to very high production of 20 to 30 tons per hectare, unimaginable, and it is very easily cultured in the things. We introduced some of the exotic species which are not good. And one example is amongst the catfish itself is a Garipinis. Some of you would have heard about it, which is a very dangerous fish. We want to eliminate that. So, but aquaculture in freshwater is concerned, it is almost standardized, but still there is a lot of scope. We would like to go for the intensification from the average of 3 tons to slightly increase the production and bring in more and more areas to think. As of today, it is supporting around 6 million tons of our total fish production. We are expecting around at least in the years by 2025-30, it will be touching around 15 to 16 million tons, which will be catering the if the water system is put in effectively use, and then some the aquaculture and freshwater was dominated mainly by the pond ecosystem. Now they are going for the cage ecosystem, small net cages are formed. Because wherein the pond is not suitable for the culture, like reservoirs and the deeper waters and the running waters, like experience in the case of Satishka. As well as the coastal aquaculture, which I am associated with, I was associated with the brackish water, as I told, it's a traditional practice, and then our resources is plenty, which will be coming in the coming subsequent life. We have got the coastal aquaculture, mainly brackish water, about 1.2 million hectares, of which only 15% is put into use. We started with a low-profile coastal aquaculture. It's a traditional way. Then we wanted to have the improvements over that by stocking selective species, go for little supplementary feeding and all. Then later it becomes more export-oriented and then income-oriented employment opportunities. New areas were brought in farming. Am I audible? New areas are put into aqua farming. One is Andhra Pradesh, as a giant in the case of giant as and the aqua farming is 70% of the farms are excavated farms right now put up at Andhra Pradesh because of the entrepreneurship and the avenues were more. And as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, though we have got around 56,000 hectares of brackish water, already we have put in about 8,000 to 9,000 hectares into use, but producing around 14,000 tons of mainly shrimps. So we would like to go for more production oriented and productivity increase. But the system is to be things, but it is not that easy. Even with the growth was exorbitant. Starting from when I started my career in 1976 in shrimp farming, reduced the manpower up to some 82-83. We were not that optimistic that the shrimp farming will go that fast. It took very steady effort, and the growth rate was annually 8 to 10% of the growth, which is none of the sectors have experienced as far as the agro sector is in India. So we experienced great things. Avenues were started. Many of our youth got employed as in different profiles, starting from production of seed, then monitoring the farm, starting from the feed manufacture, feed distribution, harvesting, and so on and so forth. That's one avenue which we could open in the case of coastal aquaculture. It's well, but nevertheless, yes, today the art is around 8 lakh tons. With very great effort, we would make sustain. The whole problem started with, and then we would like to go for, it is mainly for export orientation, but now we are not very optimistic how it will be the export in the years to come. With but we, as the slogan of Make in India, we have to create a slogan of eat in India, eat for Indian products. That has to come in because we are not very optimistic of many countries, just like China, which is a giant export importer of us, and many of the European and American countries which are economically now maybe facing a critical things. So we would like to increase the things. But the system is open. We would like to give a diversification to other species of and other farming systems like cages, pens and all is being attempted. Intensification is also going to come, which is being anticipated. One is a recirculatory ecosystem is a field of greater interest today. It is a closed aquaculture system where you need not worry about the outside problem, little water, more fish. 1 kg, 1 kilo fish is the target of the intensification, which we'll be using with a lot of gadgets for the removal of. It is a simple logic. After all, the fish cannot use the take away the water. It will only use the water for the oxygen purpose. It can take the oxygen from the water, so it uses the water for that purpose. But the rest of the water is waste. Put it into use, reuse. Take that waste product, filter it out through the things oxidized with the some of the biological filters mainly consists of the Nitrosomonas, nitrobacters like things which is oxidize the ammonia into nitrate and nitrate, which is not poisonous. And then you oxygenate it, put it. I have seen farms. Israel is one such country where even little water, more fish. The 1:1. 1 kilo fish, 1 kilo, 1 kilo water is a target. And many individuals, India is also, will be surprised. Some of my good friends at Haryana and Punjab are going for the recirculatory ecosystems with the inland saline water of the, for the Betki. So it is emerging field, lot of demonstrations, lot of things are going on. Only thing the input may be heavy, but it's remunerative. It's entrepreneurship is quite interesting. It will be, you have got lot of advantages, but there are cash, very high technical input is needed. That's the thing. As far as coming to mariculture, which is in the open water thing, offshore and floating and submerged cages, large cases you would have seen in films. Now Central Marine Fisheries is doing wonders. And then Central National Institute of Ocean Technology. These institutes are Ministry of Earth Sciences. They are putting the system of developing cage culture. They have taken the lead, some of the universities also. They put up open sea cage cultures, large ones of 30 to 36 feet dia and with 5 or 6 meter depth. The production has as high as 3 to 4 tons are obtained. Candidate species like Becky, that is a Sibas, Kobia, and Pamanos, and staffers are identified high valued, high return things. Which we are. And then people are thinking of putting up the floating net cages. Sometimes, if the cyclone is coming or there's some heavy winds, it may get spoiled. There are techniques to get the cages, put it down whenever it's not needed, it's just like adjusting the floating of the things, and it will go down because submerged winds, it will not have that much of problems. So as and when you need, we deflate it and then get it float. These submerged cages are going to come. And then only we in the institutes, only as of today it's being practiced. They're going to take in a big lead. As far as the cage culture is concerned, we are propagating in almost all the things. To start with, it has been highly practiced in some of the areas of the nearshore waters. If you go in the periphery of Karwar and the Uttarakhand district of Karnataka, you can see thousands of cages. Same thing as far as the cage Andhra Pradesh is concerned. And we have demonstrated the same in the case of Parkway and these things. Parkway is one of the potential areas. For example, Fox State has got around, it is nearer to you. It's starting from Chennai to Rameshwaram. It is a wonderful sea, very calm and quiet sea, where is now the mariculture activity is identified as a very great potential. We have got about 12,500 square kilometers. When you find 1% of the area, if it is properly used, it will put things. We are waiting for the proper policy and that already the draft policy is ready. Next, so these are some of the things. And finally, another is the ornamental fish culture. You all would have heard about. We have got the aquarium keeping as emerged as one of the hobby, not only for the hobby, it is also a health point of view. It has emerged as an interesting things both in the urban and the rural areas, because it is understood now the health is linked to the environment. Environment means something moving. If you could see in a healthy environment, your concentration is concentrated, your blood pressure or your whole health improvement, you can visualize through the seeing the pets of moving. That's excuse where me, the sir, aquarium keeping is a recreational facility. So this is both for your tourism purpose as well as the personal things. This is one thing. Ornamental fishes are things. We have our Indian ornamental industry is in a very small industry compared to the very small countries like Singapore, which is making around more than $100 billion of business with the things. The Singapore aquarium industry is very, very developed. They can create, they have created wonders in the genetic intervention, transgenics on the aquarium. Would have heard about the flower horn, different color fishes. The moment you tell within 15 days, whatever color you want, you can get the fish. So a lot of genetics have gone into the thing. We in India would like to wanted to have it a Kolathur model. Some of you would have heard about the Kolathur. An ornamental fish have been near Chennai, which is also facing a lot of problems because of another non-availability of the live feed to feed cattle the team, and then the process of urbanization has put them into problems. So we have to think for the alternatives. Some of the models are being worked out. Some of the areas are being identified for having the ornamental fish park. These youngsters can eventually interested to get involved in the things maybe coming up at near Padappai. These are the some of the activities as far as the ornamental fish is concerned. With sudden that, the aquaculture sustainability has become a big problem because of you all know the coastal aquaculture, especially you all know would have heard about the pandemic today, COVID-19. The same experience for the past 30 years, we have been experiencing in the case of 20-25 years. Our experience is worse than the, we are more experienced in the pandemic of white spot syndrome virus as then about COVID-19, what is happening today. We started with that. Whatever being told today for the COVID-19, we experienced and told the our aqua farmers to go for the things because we found it's a three-dimensional business. The ecosystem plays the thing in the middle part is the animal host, that is the shrimp. Then the next part is the host and the pathogen. The pathogen thrives in the system. When the host becomes weak and the stress, it may be salinity, maybe a pH, maybe a temperature, it gets infected. And then that comes and gets infected. That is where the WSSV, you would have heard about, thousands of crores are spent. We could, even today, we could not find a remedial for that. But we understood the roots of this proliferation, both horizontally and vertically. And we found that genetically, we should do something. That's where the selective breeding, which are the specific pathogen-free broodstocks or resistant broodstocks development programs are globally taken up. We were very slow in that, but some for their species, people have taken very lead, the Americans, and then they developed their very, very strong SPF stock of the SPF litopinus minamide. That we had been struggling. We also went into a contract, but it was not materializing. It is a little difficult species to go up with because you know the selective breeding, take a random of many families and then go for the assessment, evaluate their performance in terms of its growth, in terms of its resistance. What is resistance? They take it out, create the disease, get it out, and then best one, take it out, get bred, and then next. It's a generations of generation after five or six generations, especially in seventh generation only, we feel that it is imbibed. That's what I used to make, son. That means the seventh generation, what if a character is imbibed, it will be carried over to you. That is where the shrimp also, with up to five or six, just seven generations, we have to get the disease free or the health status. Some of the things, and then the people industry was after that, because the tiger has gone down, the scampia has gone down. We, with very great hesitation, it was permitted in 2006 or 7, and then that is now doing wonders in our waters, because that's a different species. But I can't guarantee that it will be continuing to do wonders. Even now, 30% of the farmers get loss, then 70% is okay, and another 20% is making a good profit. But nevertheless, we can't all the time delay, keep on this one, because anytime anything will happen to the trade. Because at the moment we import the broodstock from somebody, maybe from the good broodstock, and then put it in the quarantine control for a couple of about a week period. We got excellent quarantine facility by the Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, which can be even a model for the COVID quarantine before it is for putting up at our Coimbatore market or any other market, wherein the three-tier system is allowed. Even a visitor cannot get in. Excellent system where it is maintained, a foolproof system where the healthy animals are supplied to the thing. This is where they sustained, how to sustain it is a big problem. One avenue is this. So value-added products, get in, grow them, and then do the thing. Next thing to go for is the, we thought of diversification. Okay, our whole crop is now, as of today, in the coastal aquaculture, is mainly based on shrimp, shrimp, and shrimp, nothing but shrimp. This is where we want to break that point. We don't want to all the time get the slogan of shrimp, shrimp, shrimp. It's good as for making money. But to make sustainability is very difficult. I used to always say, the monocropping of aquaculture, agriculture is always a failure. You take the case of Delta, any Delta for that matter, whether it is Kaveri Delta or the Krishna Delta or any Delta, the paddy or the sugarcane, is that are two crops they will be experiencing. But then they are the worst sufferers also, many times. Because these Delta are not, otherwise cannot be put in. And then in, I come from a place where Alanya Sadan from the paddy, because it's not remunerative over the years, we all switched over the coconut. A cash crop, which was excellent. Well, I experienced, I was having some coconut per capita yield for a coconut run about 20 nuts for 20 to 30 nuts for tree. People who are with an acre of land with 40 coconut could make around, the price was also excellent. They could make 4,000 to 5,000 for 45 days. An annual income ran about 50,000 to 60,000 without any input. First, for 3-4 years, they have to suffer. And intercropping was also possible. So our economic standard was enormously increased over the years, starting from 90s. And we used to make fun after I make college. So when I was a college student, this was not possible, because that's why my father had all suffered for money. Now a lot of money is available because of the coconut. But you know, one cyclone had come, Kaja, to finish off. So I am also one of the victims. We lost everything. So anyhow, based on dependence on a single species is not an advisable. We always say the Western, for example, Tamil Nadu. Western Tamil Nadu is safe in agriculture because diverse weight crop. 1 acre of, suppose I have got 4 acres, there will be a coconut, there will be a jasmine, there will be some flowering business, there will be some jowar, there will be. So diversified crop, one will compensate in the other. That's where we diversify species. We have got an excellent galaxy of species, high valued species for that matter, which is not, which will fetch very high price. And that is the thing. And one species is the Asian sea bass, the number one as far as for the coastal aquaculture, as well as the freshwater as the marine water, Asian sea bass, latest calcarifer. And then the cobia is a kingfish. And then pambano, we have got groupers, snappers, sand bitings, sea breams, red breams. Sigan is like rabbit fishes, milkfish, gray mullets, and some of the bottom fishes, starting from the rabbit fishes, all the omnivores are herbivores, and the top fellows are the carnivores, high valued species. So we wanted to diversify the things, and the pressure was more in 1994. Now then, see, once the coastal aquaculture dependence on the shrimp collapsed, about to collapse in India, we were put under pressure to look for an alternative, and identified first one priority species was Asian sea bass. And that process we started doing the to somehow circumvent the situation, but we never thought that that will be this. At that time, we never thought the, we never thought that shrimp litopinus can be will be permitted. So our priority was on the culture of Asian sea bass, how best, how fast we can go. Because India was a new entrant at that time for the milk with finfish breeding. So we were talking from 1950s onwards about breeding without knowing its things. So most of these fishes which I earlier told, they have got a very characteristic. They come, they grow here in the backwater, even up to freshwater regime. And then eat whatever possible, nicely grow sometime because the food is eager, shallow waters. They spend less energy for hunting the feed, but they grow nicely. The osmotic balance is good in the brackish water because they prefer to have around salinity 15 to 20. So this is congenial as far as the backwater is concerned. But for maturation and spawning to lay their eggs, they have to get back into the sea, because in the shallow water, the depth is less, the temperature is high, the pH may be less, and the salt content is, salinity is less. But these requirements may not, because the reproductive hormones may not be induced. The gonadotrophins are not sufficiently induced or induced by these factors. That's why they migrate into the sea, and then there the temperatures, it's a little down, the pressure is there, the pH is there, high, and the salinity is there, which catalyzes, which helps in the development of the, or increase in the hormonal reproductive hormones, like the FSH, luteinizing, follicular stimulating trophins, and then it's again get into the stimulating hormones, GSH, like that. and then releasing hormones. So naturally, they breed there. Again, the whole story repeats. They come into the small fry or the egg sometimes. The fry or fingerlings are drifted. Wherever they have got the chance to enter into, like estuaries, they enter into the estuaries and backwaters, reach there, stay there, and then enjoy, go back. This was what they going on, and this was taken only, this is true for all the, most of the coastal aquaculture species. So this was taken advantage in the traditional farming system. But of late, it has become a big problem because none of these species seed will be abundantly available for the simple reason. We have, to the extent possible, have created problems in the coastal ecosystem. Nevertheless, we claim that our system is very fast. We have got an excellent system of very long coastline of about 8,129 kilometers, intercepted with very great, very big estuaries and backwaters, lagoons, creeks, whatnot else. And then brackish water lakes like Chilka, and then our Pulikat is there, at, we have got the Vemmanad in West Coast. These are resources are excellent. But our interventions, our usage in those systems are really sometimes we have to feel sorry for, because this most vulnerable ecosystem, coastal and the estuarine ecosystem, is the worst affected. The worst affected is the Tamil Nadu because of the obvious reasons. We don't get much of rain, and we don't get the flow of water. There is no such. Polar has become a polar. It has become almost a desert, like only 1 or 2 days in a year it gets water, if at all rain comes. Adyar is, the name itself is Adyar, is Adyadar. It means never it gets close. Today, once for all, it is close. We have got the Kuvam, it's only for the Kosatalayar, becomes things, means it becomes a drainage. So most of our urban abiding systems have become mostly polluted, starting from Tamil Nadu is one such a small creeks and estuaries, 32 estuaries bigger, and many creeks are confluencing into the seas, facilitating the juvenile fishers to enter and then go back into the sea. Once it was curtailed, no, we are at a large, big loss has happened in as far as the water bodies are concerned, and we are experiencing. This has got a say in all our production link, from starting from the things we don't have the proper drainage. Yes, because there's no continuous drainage, there's a siltation process, and then this doesn't allow our drain to get into the system. So you get it strangled, and the health problem. So many things have put into the thing. So coming to our point, so this way, our to sustain the aquaculture, we have been given the responsibilities. Thank God with my colleagues, even your own faculty, Dr. Ben was sometime associated with us, and many my colleagues were with us. And we took it as a challenge because India was not having the chance, never had the experience to breed a marine fish. Of course, ornamental fish we could do because the size is small, the habitat requirement is small, easy to feed them, manage them, handle them. But all these fishes, which I told the Becky, or the snapper, or the groupers, or the cobia, or any other fishes, is so large, it's quite a large size, which we cannot afford to handle them and grow them. So, and then we don't know how to maintain them. That's where we did a lot of, we suffered. It was a challenge, thank to my colleagues and my people who have blessed us with a lot of facilities and all. The first priority was given to the Becky, where we could breed them in captive conditions, which opened up the Pandora's box for the marine fish breeding in India today. India has got that expertise to breed about at least 8 or 9 species, both by 4 or 3 from the marine fishery side and 3 or 4 from the Brackish Water Institute side. And that is very gratifying. So, but the protocols are same. You need a captive stock. You can have the stock. Earlier, we used to think of that, getting a mother fish from the sea. No, it's not possible. But then you need to stock them as a father and mother, get them the things, give them the maturation process, what best environment it needs. We try to imitate as much as possible what the natural environment they go for. If not, even with that, it may not be possible. then through the hormonal interventions or environmental intervention, some of the environmental intervention we used to do, when the high tide comes, increase the tide water, low tide, reduce the water in the every 6 hours or so. And then with all that, even if it is not showing, the may mature but may not spawn, go for the hormonal interventions like what is available in the hormone, after all we need. But in the case of many of the species which is near shore breeders, they get to the growth step about up to the FSH will not be a problem, the growth stimulating hormones, the gonadal growth stimulating hormones, but the luteinizing releasing hormones will be a problem. The last surge is not possible. So we have to use it for some other interventions like hormonal interventions so that we induce them to spawn and then collect the egg, put it in the incubation, make them create the facilities. They have to be fed naturally. Their feed is mainly should be of small, and then but it should be ingestible and digestible, and it should be easily cultivable, and it should have the requirements of the things that way. Some of the live feed you all will be knowing, the algae we need for feed, the zooplankton like our rotifers is very important for the copepods, copepodites are all very important. And now we have got the expertise for these things in our country, and we will be very surprised. We have got Bharathidas University, a gentleman by name Dr. Sandhanam. He is doing wonderful job in the zooplankton for culture in the laboratory, and it is ready for take off to the mass culture of zooplankton. It is very difficult, but it is standardized. Algae, yes, variety of algae, but of course for the marine finfish, we need a green algae like Chlorella, Tetrasalmis, Nanochloropsis, or Isochrysis like that. Those systems have to be things. Larval ladies is how best we can go for the tank size, the tank color, so many things. And then once it becomes a thing, we should be going for the nursery rearing, because the smaller, we call it as the hatchlings. From hatchlings, it will go to small fry. Hatchlings may be about 1.5 centimeter from the millimeter. From there, it will grow as a small fry of about 1 centimeter or so. From there, it has to go as fingerlings so that it can go to the farm or cage or whatever the things. That will be around your finger size, about 5, 6, or 7 centimeter size, 4 inches, 10 centimeter size. We need to grow them. That is what we call it as the. Then we go for nurseries. In the nurseries, we will be growing them as a juveniles. Suppose a fisherman or a cage man wants to grow them in the open sea. A small fish, if you put in a big cage, it will escape sometimes. So you have to grow them as a juveniles. We call it a pre-growed juveniles of about 50 to 60 gram size, and then introduce them so that our stock is safe and the survival will be better. These systems we develop in a very time-bound manner, and for that we need I have to thank all my people who have suffered quite a lot to create. So once we have done it with the thing, a lot of fishes have come into the, into effect. The first and foremost we did was the Asian sea bass, which is my fish, which I love the fish. People around India also love it. It is a very delicacy, nice to eat. Betki is, in Hindi, it is known as betki. In Bengal, Odisha, and things, Andhra Pradesh is known as Bandukappa. In Tamil Nadu, it is called as Koralla or Koduva. In Malayalam, it is Narimin or Kalanji, and it is in Kannada, it is called as Jitada. So this is one fish which has got excellent taste, texture, and flavor, which used to be frequent those days when we were having a lot of confluence with the sea. The Kaveri Delta system, Godavari or Krishna are the things. But now man-made structures, embowments doesn't allow them to come nearer. And the food availability, production in the backwaters are also less. Nevertheless, lot of mortality. The greatest problem with these fish is differential growth. It is highly cannibalistic in the young ages. It's not telling. The interesting point is the biological is proto-androus hermaphrodite. That means to start with, many of them are males, and as they grow large, they become females. So protoandrous, that is the, it has got protracted, a fish may spawn many times in a thing in a year, 3 or 4 times, and this always the smaller the males and the larger fishes are the females. So we will be collecting the females. It is a biological thing. So we will be collecting the brood stock, or we will be from the pond or the cages, and then putting them in our big tanks for holding them. This is what we used to do. And our holding facilities at Muttukada, you can see, if at all anybody has got the chance, it's very big tanks. We used to keep them and change the water, feed them with the forage fishes like tilapia. So it's very good. It matured, and then we will be assessing the maturation by inserting a small cannula in the oviduct, because it's not that easy like a thing. This whole process was achieved first time in the 10th of July 1997. All of you may be remembering, any aquaculture may be knowing, that the 10th of July is every day is celebrated as the Fish Farmers Day, because that is a day when the induced major calves was industriously bred in captive conditions by Harlal Chowdhury and Dr. Likuni, who made a breakthrough that only paved way for the whole of this Indian fish, inland fish production. Today, we have about 6 million tons, what is going on. To commemorate that day only, this is celebrated as the Fish Farmers Day. It coincidentally, this first marine food fish is also was bred on 10th of July 1997, after 40 years of the carp was bred, thanks to my colleague. So we got the first breeding, and that has paid the base for many of our things. We did induced breeding in this to start with. We will be selecting with the males and females. Males which has got the running just to press abdomen, the white milk will come, and then females will be taking from the after cannula. If the egg size is around 450 microgram, we will be selecting her and then putting them. Normally we selected 2 males for 1 female and give an injection, a small dose of about luteinizing release in hormone of analog, which is produced by the Glasgow as well as the this company. So this one we will be incorporating this, injecting intramuscularly. After 35 hours, it will spawn and the eggs will be floating on the surface. Always the pelage, the eggs will be metallized, the eggs will be floating because of the buoyancy. If they're not fertilized, the eggs will settle down at the bottom. We will be removing the unfertilized eggs and take the egg into the incubatory facilities like this. And then there the aeration conditions will be maintained as it is mentioned. That will give the hatchlings to us. So we will be putting the hatchlings in the that will, by the time it hatches out, it will be around 1.5 to 3 to 4 millimeter size, just like a rice bran size, and then transferring them to the thing. Before that, we will be preparing the feed for them, because live feed is very important. It's not important for the fish to be fed directly. This has to be fed to the feed, another feed, rotifers and the copepods, which we will be maintaining separately. That is where we maintain the algal culture in such facilities like Oxoni culture. From there, we will go about the batch culture, like that bucket culture, carboy culture, batch cultures, which will be inoculated in larger facilities as a concentrated farm, and then make it as a facility called algal culture. We will be, after transferring, we will feed them with the larva rearing tanks with the Rousseau protocol. The larvae will thrive of its own egg yolk egg for a couple of days, and from third day onwards we have to feed them with the standard feed. The best feed in the earlier stage seems to be the, we are trying to develop some formulated diet like a micro encapsulated micro particulated diets which can be ingested, and that because feed is very difficult to develop for the larvae, because the larval, the nutrition is a difference. The needs a lot of different type of amino acids, fatty acids. It has to be, first of all, the particle has to be ingested, digested. That's more important. So size is more important, buoyancy is more important. Then the animal's aptitude is at the bottom. Already come for the Asians, European sea bass. There's a cousin of it in Europe, which is called as Dicentrachus labrax. They are developing that one. So we will be starting feeding them with the rotifers. and then go up to 7 or 8 mm. By the time from 1.5 millimeter it would have grown about 3 to 4 millimeter size. The mouth size also, at the beginning it will be around 100 micron, 120 micron size, which can ingest only the rotifers. Then of late it can ingest at a slightly larger particles, larger animals. That is what we use, is Artemia knob. Artemia, you all may be knowing, it's a brine shrimp. Artemia is excellent food. Artemia and aquacultures are inseparable. If the aquaculture today is grown up means, that means the hatchery production of seed, where the hatchery production of seed was possible only to the Artemia knob. Artemia is a brine shrimp which thrives in the salt pans like our Kalambakkam or Tuticorin or any place like that, Marakkanam. And even some of the interior areas, you would have heard about Salt Lake and all. It's a big trade in the aquaculture industry. India itself is importing to the extent of about 3,000 to 4,000 crores worth of Artemia annually for the feeding that larvae in the hatchery. So the Artemia is a wonderful animal. It thrives in the seawater. You know, the salt pans will be, the salts production is start with the seawater or the ground saline water pumping. Hold it, they call it as the reservoirs. From the reservoirs, they will be taking it to the concentration ponds, which is shallow ponds. By that time, from the seawater, it will be around 35-40 ppt. In the reservoir pond, it will be around 100 ppt or so. By that time, it goes to the evaporation pond, it will be around 300-400. These interesting animals, which is thriving in the seawater, normal seawater, as an opale, will be by the process of 15 days, they will also be growing as adult. But then by the hell, when they enter into the high saline regime, with the low oxygen, high pH, high salinity, they become nervous, and then they release their egg as a cyst. This is what is called as a cyst, dormant eggs, which will be floating on the in the sea, in the salt pans and around, which will be collected and then dried, packed, and it's a big industry today. So when it gets ambient seawater, normal salinity, it will hatch out into tiny nauplie, which is around 100 micron, more than 200 micron size, which can be used by the larvae of the shrimp, larvae of the fish. This is what is we always say, Artemia aquaculture is inseparable. This is one thing which we do, the larva rearing, feeding them with the first 10 days with the rotifer, then for another week or so with the combination of rotifer, because they will be smaller. This sea bass is very interesting. Not only sea bass, many of the marine fish, finfish larvae in the early stages are differential growth. Some will be very big, some will be small. So there is a tendency for them to be feed on their cousins, their siblings. This is what we call it as cannibalism. It is cannibalism is yes, genetic or environmentally induced. It's a big science to study. Cannibalism is it genetic, and hierarchy is genetic, or it's environmentally stimulated things we don't know, instinct. Because one thing, as in the Indian society or any other community, if a man becomes rich, he will continue to be rich. The poor will become poorer, poorer, poorest. Like that in sea bass also, the one it has grown up big will be always growing big. We call it them as a shooters. By the time they go nearby, the smaller fellows will be at the backside. That's what we call it as very small siblings. So the differential growth, which is a hierarchical maintained, it's true with the cobia, it is true with the many other fishes, snappers, groupers. So we have to see that after some stage they are uniform size fishes are put in together. But if we put the next group will start. So 30% of the population has got a tendency to grow faster in a system. That's what we do that in the grading process. This is what we call it as a grading. And then the seeds are taken, supplied. Now it is a small industry type of things. But still, even today, though we have got only two government-owned hatcheries, one is Shiba, and another is one is at the Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, because in 2002, they wanted to, alternative was their priority. So 1997, they approached us, we gave them the transfer the technology to them, and it, then the, by the time they got the refinement through the counterparts in Australia also. Now they are doing a good job of breeding them, the breeding and seed production of CBAS is a very sustained industry as of today. And the culture of CBAS is going in a small way. Not small way, it's valiant, but no authoritative data is not available. It may be around 15 to 20,000 tons as of today. Given the frontier, my knowledge in the Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka and Maharashtra, Kerala, these places now do the farming in a small scale farming system, and somebody is doing large scale farming. Somebody are doing, there are two types of farming. One, the traditional way of doing, knowing that fish is a carnivore, feeding mainly on trash fishes, and we can go for the fishes with the low cost fish feeding. Now people are trying to develop the farm related feed. To some extent it is successful also, but for example grow based it tried, and then some other fishes are also, the feed is also imported with a good FCR. So CBAS farming is a sustained industry today. Many farmers who were adopting earlier the shrimp farming, which is very risky oriented and problematic sometimes in marketing and all these issues, it has got a great potential. But this year there's a small setback, because normally Andhra Pradesh farmers used to say grow larger fish CBAS about 3 kilos and above, which will fetch them around 2000 rupees a kilo, because 500-600 to 700 rupees a kilo at Bengal, because Bengal festivals in the months of a lot of marriages and all during months of February, March, April. But the pandemic COVID has spoiled the whole thing, and people are in the alarm, even selling the fish for 400-500 rupees is a big problem. So when we demonstrated this process of target culture of CBAS and showing them the demonstration of the nursery, how to grow the fry from, you can get from the hatchery, grow them as a fingerling. This is one group. There's another group who will getting the fingerlings to the juveniles. There is another group. The juveniles are being sold to the cage farmer, whoever it is, or a pond culturist who will be doing third kill. So this value chain we showed them, where the fish of 1 rupee in the hatchery, a fry, is reared and sold for 15 rupees as a fingerlings. And that fingerlings are 15 rupees as a 30 rupees a juveniles. And 30 rupees a juvenile fish goes for 500 rupees a kilo, 600 rupees a kilo in a year. It means the whole process is 1 year. I mean 2 months in the hatchery, 1.5 months in the hatchery, 1.5 months in the nursery, 1.5 months, another 1.5 months in the things of the 4.5 months, and 7 to 8 months in the grow out system, which fetches them in their good remunerative things, which is everything. I guess now then it is picking up. We hope so that India will also be going with their entrepreneurship on the cage farming. Yeah, this is not a joke. Many of the fishes which I've been telling, snapper, grouper, mainly betki. If we go to Thailand, Bangkok is just like a Kerala, it looks like, and Samut Prakan, these provinces, people will be having some few or five cages in the behind their thing, and about 500, 600 fishes will be there. Uniform size fish you will sort out and keep it in their cages, and then they will come and cuddle you and then ask you, sir, do you want fish? Yes, sir. How many fishes? 300 fishes, because everywhere the society is same. In a marriage, a function and all, you have to supply uniform fish for all, otherwise the relatives will be angry. So you will be asking 300 fishes uniform size, you will pull out one cage and give them premium price. This is what I think in the marketing strategy, so many things. So you will get the premium price, and then his stock is also complete. The cup of entrepreneurship, we hope for the youngsters will pick up in the years to come, and the departments also will create awareness among the youngsters to start such an activities, so that we are quite sure that all cannot be or will not be employed by the government, but they will be giving you a loan as per the new norms and all. So we have to get equip ourselves, those who are youngsters who will be graduating or who will be technically qualified skill developments, create such an avenues. It is interesting also. It's not a very big thing. A small 100 square meter area, not even. In Vietnam, one lady, gently a family is making a beautiful, big money. It's a recreational tourism facility. Over the cages, small cages put out in the water, there will be a very nicely glass-topped thing. Over that, the restaurant will be there. So we will be enjoying and paying a premium price for that tea and the snacks. And the entry ticket is also there. We snap about 20, 25 so species of fishes are there. The children will be very fascinated and created an interest. This sort of entrepreneurship will be coming, we hope so. Many other people are doing that. This is what we are doing with the Becky. His story is very interesting. We demonstrated throughout India, so to say, almost except the inland side, Kashmir. I could make it in even Rajasthan, but this frontier, East Coast, Rajasthan, and Patinda, like salinized area of Punjab, Haryana, and then all these places, it is it has picked up. Now people start thinking of in that line. Why not? I use my ground saline water and put a small farm of aquaculture of becky. Becky is a very high valued fish. And then we have got many other species which are followed by the same protocol. Maybe the hormones will be slightly different. For example, snappers have got the Lugianus species, which has got a very high potential for our things. It will be another high value species. I was told now recently, Centralista brachyshot aquaculture got a breakthrough in breeding and flower rearing of the snappers too. And we have the other fish, you would have heard about the grouper, Kalava in Tamil. And it is very interesting, it's a protogynous. Means start with the many are females, and as they grow large, they are becoming females, males. So that's why we have developed some technology, techniques to develop the, to retain at least the maleness, to develop the maleness in the way by administration of alpha methyl 17 alpha methyl testosterone and through the feed. We will be injecting them into the feed tilapia and giving to them. Then that will be converting some time or retained as a male. So that was successful and we could breed them in captive. Protocol for the larva rearing and all the same for these species too. It's also high valued species. Many programs are sorted out because for the live marketing of grouper was a big proportion, very high price it best. You see, the Maldives is one country where they are doing wonderful business as far as the grouper is concerned. A battery chain of the grouper cages, small cages, and then they do that and then live send it through shipment to other countries because Taiwan, Taiwanese and Chinese pay anything for this. Taiwan pays a very high amount for, I don't know what for. They pay a very high premium price for this grouper's type. So that's where the fish, we don't like that much, but it's a highly relished fish in that area. Of course, the talk of the day is the cobia, which is the fish of future, we call it. It's a kingfish. We call it in Tamil, cuttle varal. It's just like a, it's a normotic fish. Roaming under the sea, crab water, very highly predaceous, carnivore, and very nice fish to grow. No fish will grow in the captive condition as cobia. They are very comfortable in a cage, marine cage, as big as 80 kilos in a year. Means imagine the potential of the fish to grow. So, this is we gave a mandate under the National Agriculture NAP programs, we could make them breed very small, but we thought this is a very big fish, how to maintain them in a small pond. But basically, we could make them in a small pond of about 300 square meter, 500 square, 500 kilograms of biomass of cobia and make them breed. My sister institute, Central Marine Fisheries Institute, is doing now excellently. If you happen to, some of you happen to go to Mandapam, you can enjoy the people nearby Rameshwaram, nice place, and then they are doing wonders with that. Phobia is spread continuously now. It's again, as far as the biology is concerned, more or less like SIBAs or SNAPAs, group wise. It's a fast growing. But the lesser salinity, lesser the growth in the pond, it will get only 2 to 3 kilos in a year. In the cages, potential is exorbitant. That's why we say the marine cages, it is going to revolutionize our fish production. We hope so. And the marketing, it will be the flavor and texture more or less like the seer fish. You know, seer fish, vanjiram, is a fish which is now sought after very much. For two reasons, the present generation is do not know how to peel out the bones from the fish and eat the flesh. Because many of our young ladies also don't know how to clean the fish. And these are all big problems. So we prefer to have a fish which is scaleless, but easy to cook, easy to eat. No bones should go inside because the children should not cry. So these are all our priorities nowadays. So seer fish is now sold at a very high premium price, up to 1,000 rupees, 1,200 rupees a kilo because of the texture. Put in a small piece. I have nuclear family, 4 pieces will do. 2 children and the husband and wife, 1 month each. So 4 pieces, each one weighing at about 100 gram size. But I will get about half a kilo or 400 grams for the about 500 rupees. Go in the late in the evening, put it in the frying pan, whatever the shape you get, you put it in the dish, fry. That's the the biggest thing. We are not very sure how much they taste. It all varies with people. But that advantage the cobia too have, that the slice can be as good, as thin, as fine the texture of the thing. That's why this fish is given high priority in the cage farming in the open sea. Hopefully it will pick up. And the technology for seed production is already available in India. And silver pomfret quite has succeeded. And we are also trying to do breeding of the broodstock of silver pomfret species of high value. After that, there are low valued species which are, but in some places, for example, grey mullet, McGill safaris. So one species is widely distributed in the Indo-Pacific. Herbivorous and is a detritus breeder, grows nicely, easy to compatible, can be grown with the shrimp, grown with the another fish. But the only thing is the great problem is with the availability of the seed. For example, Kerala and West Bengal love the fish. In Kerala, Tilda, you would have heard about in the Malayali knowing. Tilda is one of the costliest fishes. And of course, it has got its own taste. The Tilda of Kerala has got, especially the Pemrod coil, has got a different taste. So they love the fish. And so they want to grow the fish in a very sustained manner, it can be grown. But the only thing to make it as a farming, where from the seed will go. So a Kerala farmer from any R&D institutions look forward only techniques and technology, large scale seed availability of Tilda, that is the McGill safaris. We have the institutes have successfully at least bred and produced a seed which has already been demonstrated to the people. It's a long way to go because many countries, Egypt, Iran, going ahead with
sir, we are running short.
We'll be completing it in
a brief case. And we can have the questions.
Milkfish is another fish which we can think of. Well, some of the things which we are thinking of. So breeding and control has got its own challenges. All of you have explained the thing. So this is what I want to discuss with you all. So for the academicians, you have got a lot of opening as far as the research point of it is concerned. Each and every component of the aquaculture has got a component in that, built-in component of research component in the things. Each one can be programs as entrepreneurship. Breeders, brood development, broodstock development, live feed development, and then you can sell the live feed, you can sell the broodstock, you can sell the market, you can sell the scientists, you can develop the center for the selective breeding. And feeding, food, how, this, a lot of the transgenics, another important field which we are course, we have not yet permitted the transgenic fishes, especially except salmon. But still, there is a lot of research scope on that. You would have heard about the mackerel, tuna out of mackerel, a small fish to avoid the female gymen, you know, of this one. Tuna and get the tuna out of mackerel is a big story. It's going to be commercialized. So a lot of avenues are there in the aquaculture sectors, entrepreneurship, and then with the coming of blue economy papers, you all would have seen in the Google and things. We are hoping for very large, great emphasis on the fish and the fish farming and the aquaculture. I wish you best of luck. Thank you very much. I have taken a lot of time. If any question is there, you are most welcome. I am ready to answer.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful and very lucid presentation, very informative one. We could see a lot of compliments in the chat box, more than the questions, and they are thanking you. Sir, we have few questions. Dr. Shivkumar, he has asked, what are all the requirements to get subsidies and financial assistance to establish an aqua farm?
Aqua farm is now what type of farm you are going to have? NFDP is novel species. For the shrimp farms establishment, they have stopped. For the novel species like a catfish, a little bit of anamide, and the sea bass farms, and group on this type of farming, they are ready to subsidize. Up to 30% subsidy is coming. And cage culture, they are ready to subsidize for the establishment of the farm system. That is still like for the novel innovative species. Innovative species, not for the old species. Anamai is included, catfish is included, and then Sibas is included in that. Prepare a project proposal, submit it to the NFDB, and to it's only refinancing business. You can avail the loan. Either any bank, and then they will be refinancing to the extent of 30% maximum.
Is there any place where culturing of pelagicus is available? Culturing of pelagicus crab?
Pelagic crabs, sir.
Not at commercial. Yeah. Pelagicus is the scope is there, but not typical. It's not commercialized. Only the experimentally some institute like CMFRA does. That's not at commercialized. No farmer is doing because our farming of a crab, as far as is concerned, only mud crab. It is being in small scale. It is being done by women entrepreneurs, low income group, as a group activity in Kilda. You can see Polikat and Kulathamede, some ladies are doing. And the Nagale Ganga, Godavari near, they are Krishna, they are doing. It's an activity now done as social improvements, mainly for the self-help women we promoted. They are sustaining it. The two process. One crab, one is a fattening, another is from starting from the small ones to the larger ones. Fattening is easier because but you need a molted crab, which is a day by day shrinking. Now they are also like sea bass, we advocate now there are two groups, one for the growing as a small crab and the adult crab. Like that, you know. Not at the pelagicus is not a commercial farm yet in India.
Hi, sir. Good afternoon, sir. This is Gopalakrishna. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Please.
Yeah, sir. Good afternoon. Gopalakrishna, Marine Biology.
Good afternoon.
Sir.
Thank you.
Very good. I have a it's not a question, of course, suggestion. Sir, since, of course, we do concentrate on carnivore aquaculture, it consumes low value fishes. Of course, though it is a low value fishes, it is not a useless. Of course, it is being eaten by some section of our people, they are consuming it. But in that case, if you 100% depend on the low value fish or the trash fish, which whatever it is, But there is a conflict between human consumption and animal consumption, right? But how we can, we are going to it in case of expansion of this technology to more areas. This is my question, sir.
Yes, sir. No, in the aquaculture, or I will tell the answer. It's very simple. You are throughout the world. Throughout the world, it is a big question because the low value is not a concept. Everything has got a value. So in that case, are you audible? I am audible. Everything has got a value. It's a question of relative value. For example, if the sea bass is sold at the rate of about 700-600 rupees or farm gate price of 500 rupees, and tilapia is sold at the rate of 30 rupees or farm gate price of 20 rupees, and the difference is, if we give 5 kilos or 6 kilos of the live tilapia, I will get 1 kilo of sea bass or groupers, whatever it is. So my input in terms of feed cost is only to the extent of 6 into 25 is 150 rupees as a feed cost, my seed cost. So I feel comfortable in farming this type of fishes, which is being sold. I produce my own, there are farms. You will be seeing, you will be surprised. If you want, you can go to Krishna district and see. Because when we started demonstrating to the people, feeding them with the tilapia or any live feed, it's a global business going on. They used to get for the kurka. This tilapia was hardly about 3 to 5 rupees a kilo. So once a demonstration was successful, they started getting 30 rupees a kilo. That is another way of improving their livelihood options. So now then it is not available. Yeah. People are buying or producing tilapia, especially Mozambique, which is very Arthrodon Mozambique, it's a prolific breeder, which can be produced with that for a cost of about 10 to 15 rupees a kilo and sold about 25 rupees a kilo. This is one avenue. But nevertheless, for a large expansion of the aqua farm, or the carnivorous fishes are not the candidates. That's why we say it is not that visualization of 7 million tons or 6 million tons is going to be with the carnivorous fishes. I have put my own yardstick about 50,000 tons of sea bass, 50,000 tons of groupers, 70,000 tons of cobia, and not more than about 50 tons of this pampano. So variety of this about 7 or 8 varieties, which will be around in the order of about 7 to 8 for about 0.5 million of cultivable fish, which will be supplementing. That much only is advocated. Somebody will be telling, I will produce about 1 million tons of these fishes. No, we don't. As an aquaculturist, if we are things, we don't visualize very high. Govarakshan visualize about, if you say, you can say about 100,000 tons of sea bass. Good. Great achievement. 100,000 tons of many other species, 8 or 9, which I told. That itself is 1 million ton target of the finfishes, carnivores, is enough for the for India to supplement the aqua farm. No, it's not a huge expansion as that of the shrimp. Shrimp expansion also, yes, for the obvious reasons, all of you know, that is for export oriented. We don't know years to come how it will behave. If not, the shrimp is sold at the rate of about 500 rupees a kilo, all are down now. They will bite their fingers and now, next, if anybody.
Thank you, sir. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Hello, good afternoon. This is Perumal from Bharatiya University. Do you hear me, sir? Good afternoon, sir. Perumal.
I am hearing. Tell me.
And very nice of you. I have heard the lecture. Thank you, sir. So, you have discussed about the viral problem.
Thank you.
COVID as well as shrimp problem. So we did some work, some Birna virus pertaining to our this thing via our copy ports. So whether it is animal virus or animal health point of view or human health point of view, whatever it is, basic research remains the same. When we are going to the virus, what would you suggest for future line of research to young researchers at large, whether animal or plant or human? After all, virus same. Thank you.
No, virology is a big science now. Then it has global attention is in. There are a group of virus. The biggest problem in Indian virology was, though the institutes were in existence and then doing some good work, we woke up very recently after the COVID, it's a human virology is concerned. As far as our animal viruses, virology is about veterinary related virology is well established. You would have heard about FMF disease, foot and mouth disease. Even today, that is a very challenging disease as far as the virus disease in the animals are concerned, foot and mouth disease. And the shrimp, aquatic animals, the white spot or any other virus is a pandemic, and even today it's a challenging problem. It's not that easy to find a solution. It is maybe easy to have the diagnosis with a lot of diagnostic tools. Now you have got the technology to develop the cloning process, magnifying it, putting it in the synthetic process, and the instruments are there where amplifiers are there and tell you, yes, this is this virus is there, if not. But to some extent, we were very happy, even for the white shrimp, our Indian shrimp industry, diagnostic tools were very nice. But in the aquatic animals, the problem was they were not having the advanced memory cells as we have, as the higher animals do have. That's why the vaccine is always a problem. It was non-specific immunity. So the immunity development was given priority through feed or through the very other things like probiotics, feed stimulants, increasing the feed with the probiotics. So many attempts are made. Mostly it all would have been with the microflora, which is like a bacillus like of things, which is again we are also doing with the animals. Even the human pandemic COVID, nutrition is one point which is attacked now to increase your immunity. But one fortunate thing is the vaccines are possible to develop. There are many processes, and then here we have got the admitted vaccine development. And then we are using. So aquatic animal working by these zoologists, maybe virologists will be having a different look in a human health point of view. But an aquatic animal would have been taken a model. It is not the absolute as far as the human health is concerned. It can be a model. For example, I told, you know, quarantine model. It's the same thing. Distancing was told there. Cleaning was told. All of you may be knowing, perhaps Govarishan knows, we told in our best management practices and good management practices about all the aspects which is told today for the COVID-19 is told by 5 years back in the shrimp industry. Wash your hands, put your hands, distancing yourself, wash your vehicles. All the things were put in quarantine yourself. All these feed was quarantined. So many things were done there. And of course, in terms of numerical numbers, it was easier there. Here it is because they will not go away from us. It is very difficult to control human beings than any other animals or plants. So this is the only way out. That can be a model. This can be which can be replicated. It is all interested depending upon the field which you are telling. Models can be with the aquatic animals, can be. Even we suggested the model of quarantine, what is existing for aquatic quarantine, had it been represented, had it been used in the quarantine of our Coimbatore type of quarantine system, would have been a better. It would have easily done it, that process, but perhaps animals are not looked after as human beings are taken care of. It depends upon the person. It can be a model you can use and work on that, which can be some of our colleagues who are who worked in the shrimp disease are only now in the vaccine development for the pandemics, for your information, in the National Institute of Immunology. This one is there.
Thank you, sir. Now, sir, I request our Vice Principal, Madam, Dr. LRS Kalvamuthi, Madam.
Sir, this is Dr. Santhanam from Bharathidasan University, Marine Science Department.
Thank you.
So, thank you.
Sir, we are running short of time for the next meeting, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, I now our Vice Principal, ma'am, Dr. LRS Kalanidhi, ma'am, to give the concluding remarks of the session. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Dr. Mahindra. I deem it an honor to propose a word of thanks along with my concluding remarks for this inaugural session of the 5-day Industry Academia Conclave 2020 on Aquaculture Avenues, Opportunities and Challenges. At the outset, I heartily thank our most respected resource person, the father of CBAS, Dr. A.R. Thirunal Karasu sir, for having spared his valuable time and for sharing his knowledge and experience with us on coastal aquaculture's perspectives. Sir, very interestingly, your presentation served as an eye-opener to us in knowing more about aquaculture, its significance, status, India's contribution to 85% of the total inland fish production, freshwater aquaculture, mariculture, ornamental fish culture, sustainable aquaculture, saltwater fish breeding in India, fish farmers day, that's very interesting, induced spawning, live feed culture, and finally the thrust areas of research. Shortly, A to Z of aquaculture, coastal aquaculture, you explained, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your scholarly presentation and for answering the participants' questions very, very patiently and scholarly. Thank you so much, sir. At the home front, I thank our General Secretary.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I thank our General Secretary and correspondent, Mr. Manjit Singh Nair ji, for his sustained support and encouragement in all our endeavors.
Please continue.
I thank our respected principal, Dr. M. G. Raghunathan, who himself is a renowned scientist and an expert, not only in his subject, but all subjects, and he's a successful administrator as the principal, managing hundreds of staff and thousands of students. Thank you very much, sir, for your graceful presence and for delivering the welcome address for this wonderful 5-day conclave. I thank wholeheartedly the Dean School of Research, Dr. J. Jayanti, for her continuous initiatives in promoting research and for organizing such a mega event. Thank you, madam. I thank the eminent deans of various schools, heads, and members of all departments of Guru Nanak College for her excellent support for the success of this 5-day Industry Academia Conclave 2020 on aquaculture. Thanks to all dignified participants from north to south and from east to west, from across our country, from various places of eminence for your graceful presence in this program. This program could be a grand success with the able technical support given by the host, Dr. Mahendra Kumar, Assistant Professor of Biotechnology, Guru Nanak College. Thank you very much, sir, for your support throughout the program. I thank our energetic students who keep themselves busy by engaging with their online classes in the morning and in such enlightening webinars in the afternoon. Thank you, students. You will definitely benefit out of all these programs arranged by our college. Finally, I thank one and all who have gracefully graced this occasion. We will again meet tomorrow at 2 p.m. for the 2nd day event. Hearty welcome to you all tomorrow. And thank you very much for the opportunity given to me. Thank you very much.
Want to know more about these topics? Please follow us at Guru Nanak Center for Research YouTube page, Facebook, Instagram, and don't forget to subscribe our channel. Thank you.